Good evening and namaste. Welcome to Chatinar. To our three eminent speakers and all the people who are attending, delightful to come back with another episode of Chatinar going live. As usual, this is an interactive session with all the questions coming in from attendees, either during registration or during the live session as well. If you would let me, I would very quickly introduce our three speakers today. Three eminent people, three, at least in my mind, absolute heroes for their individual work, for making their teams go through what they did for a particular reason. You will see as we go along. So if I may introduce as I see them on my screen, Simon Kumar Singh, he is an IPS of 96 Kadar in Karnataka. He is currently the IGP of Central Range in Bangalore. However, during the time that we will refer to multiple times, perhaps, he was IGP admin, same region. What did happen was during the lockdown, with the migrant workers being almost in a disarranged situation, they were looking for food, looking for mechanisms to be able to go back home for at least a period of time. Simanji's phone number got distributed out, spread out all over as the helpline number, inadvertently. What one would have expected a normal individual to do is get that number scrubbed out and stop responding to that phone, maybe change the SIM. He didn't do that. He became the helpline. He became the helpline, fielded himself hundreds of calls directly or on WhatsApp. And there's a very large overall exercise that happened. Across of Bangalore, food grains being distributed from donations coming in, all the way to the migrant workers. He continued to do that with a large police force, enough for tailwind finally to start coming in from the different neighboring states as well, different other districts besides just Bangalore. Very, very large effort. He continued to help the migrant workers go back home. And now, if I remember right, as Simanji mentioning, he's helping them come back to Bangalore. So that's Simon Kumar Singh, IPS. Going over to Swami Anuraganandan. Swamiji is chief functionary of Ramakrishna Mission in Chirapunji, now known as SORA. So he runs, hear this out, he runs 81 schools in remote locations all across 11 districts in Assam and in Meghalaya. Many of them are very, very remote, which means no road access. You've got to be able to walk on foot for many kilometers to be able to get there, all completely right next to the Bangladesh border. As you are aware, the terrain there is not really very hospitable either. Besides that, during the lockdown, and I remember this number particularly, for the first 2 months, he fed, by he, I of course mean the Ramakrishna Mission team there, fed 37,440 families. Provided isolation facilities to 841 percentage. There is some amount of tech innovation which came in, which I will talk about or we will refer to as we go during the conversation. Moving on to Dr. Rajan, Dr. Sujit Rajan is a practicing, fairly well-known respiratory physician in Bhatia Hospital and Bombay Hospital, Bombay of course. Due to the nature of his work, due to him being a respiratory physician, he obviously is and was at that time a frontline worker. There is no reason for him to be there because of his seniority right there at the front line, but he was. As you would expect, he did contract COVID-19 as well. The level of commitment is, after doing all that, after recovering, he was immediately back at the hospital because he felt the need to be there. He also, interestingly, and very crucially, finds interest in treating and talking with terminal stage patients today. So with that, we'll start off. And I'll start off with a very fundamental, basic question, which I might come back with a different tone towards the end. First is, let me just do a round robin and go with everybody. What really makes you do this? you're doing something phenomenal. And if you would also talk a little bit about what you actually did, where does this commitment come from? Each of the three of you did this way beyond what you were supposed to do. Simanji, your job did not demand this, for sure. Swamiji, you continue doing the other usual social welfare type of stuff. The kind of tech innovation that you brought in was not required. Nobody would have said anything. Same for you, Dr. Rajan. Just after get from COVID, you did not need to jump back in right then. Nobody would have said anything. What makes you do this? What's that motivator?
Thank you, Mr. Swas, for the nice, kind introduction you gave. And a warm welcome to all other participants, Swamiji, Doctor, and other people who are joined here. First and foremost, it's a very difficult question you have asked, because you know there cannot be a straightforward answer to this. It is something I am sitting here before you, and by God's grace, you know, I'll just try to relate. One of the very old persons whom I keep referring to, like I keep asking him for some advice and all, he's a religious leader. He told me, look, Sivant, you were feeding these people. It's not that you have done something great. Had you not done it, someone else would have fed them. They would not have died. But your number became viral. People came to know your number. They approached you. And you became a means to which the food was distributed. So I took it. I thought that, yes, look, I got a chance here. I got a chance to do something because of my position. Had I not been in this position, I would not have been able to do it. And to my luck, I had just worked in the city police as an additional commissioner 2 years continuously, and was posted a few months back as Inspector General of Police Administration in the police headquarters. So I knew the city very well. I knew the officers very well. I knew the areas very well. The situation from my side, from what position I was having and what power I was wielding, and the demand of the situation, my number becoming viral. I could not just sit like that and see that people were crying, literally crying. And the advantage I had, a big advantage, was the language, because most of the workers were from North India, be it Bengal, Bihar, Odisha, or Jharkhand, UP. They were very, very happy with me conversing in local Hindi language. So it was really very, I could not just stop at that. If someone is asking for help, I cannot just say, okay, look, mera wo kaam nahi. So I had to do. So I started in a very, very small manner, very, very small manner. And I thought it is at that. I never thought it will become. And towards the end, just for the information of everyone, the value of the goods which were given, ration, is a mind-boggling about 6 crores. And not a single money we collected, no financial transactions. It was only in terms of kind. So as the course of this thing we go, so all these things, you know, it gave me a kick. I thought that, look, I am in this position. People are looking up to me to help. If I don't help, they will go to some other person. So if I am in a position to help, just like I suppose doctor would have also appreciated this. He was in COVID and he came back and he started treating, because he has that quality. Swamiji is treating, going around and spreading the word, social work and education. So we have that power. It is just that we have used it in the positive way. Sorry. So nothing, there is no framework that, yes, we have to do this and we have to achieve this much, then achieve that much. It is just like by God's grace and a positive attitude. And it sometimes I used to be like so much pressed with this problem, because the number of calls are so huge, 400 to 500 calls per day, and arranging logistic for them was so difficult. So I used to get bogged down, like what to do. But then, you know, one leads to other leads to another. So just improvising the things and all. So it is nothing that everything is laid out. It just happened. And if God forbid such situations come up in future, it may be in some other form, it will always be an experience for me to further improve the situation. This should not come, this COVID things and all these should not come. But yes, no one expected this, and in a lighter vein, I'll tell you, I am from Bihar, but I'm settled in Jharkhand. You know, the elections are going on in Bihar. Someone said that you should come and fight for elections. I just told you, the funniest part is that I am a police officer. Because of this, being a police officer, I could help so many people. So I'll be a fool that from something very, very constructive and definite which I have with me, to go into something which is uncertain. Yes, if that helps me in helping people, but I don't know, that's a different field. But I am very happy of being a police officer and being able to help in such a large manner. I had been doing this throughout my career, but in a very small manner, very, very small manner. And I used to do it on my own and keep it to myself. But this became viral. So I, Mr. Suhas, you have seen it very closely, how it happened. So I suppose all Swamiji or doctor and all other people who are trying to bring something and do something for society, don't have anything laid down. They keep trying to improve, and God's wish is that it gets improved. That's my take on that.
Very rightly, spoken by Simanji. You see, as he has mentioned, this is nothing, something which you plan. It happens. And see, in our life, we come across situations where it is given for us to really help people or to, you know, just walk away from there. And it so happens that I was in a position to help them. And I really took up that challenge, as mentioned by Simanji. In our case also, it happens in a very small way. 24th March, if you remember, the lockdown was declared. I was at Delhi. In fact, I took one of the last flights to reach back. And that very early morning, we received a phone call from a single mother. And she had suffered partial paralysis. Half of her body was not functioning. And she had to support 5 to 6 children in her house. Nobody to take care of. So immediately she called. She said, her children called, that this is the condition of their mother and there is no food, there is no medical help, nobody is coming to take them. So that is what gave us an idea. I said, she's not the only one who must be suffering. So why don't we start a helpline? So we immediately started a helpline, first brought this lady, and we have a dispensary, gave her physio treatment for next 10 days and supplied food grains to her house. And then immediately started through WhatsApp, to all our well-wishers, because we have large number of schools we run, to parents, teachers, and all that. We said, if anybody is really in dire need, ask them to immediately contact these numbers. And that is how the movement started growing. I also never expected that it is going to become very big. But then every day, more and more area, people from different areas, they started approaching us. And then Meghalaya is totally dependent on, food grains from neighboring state of either Guwahati, that's Assam, or from West Bengal. And the problem was, during COVID, you just could not move any lorries from one state to another state. And the stock in the our state was very less. And the government was trying to procure all of that. So we were really, how much time. The problem with the government is that they do things in a very big way, but it takes time for them to react. It's a big machinery, after all. For us, we are like a commando force. We can move very fast. So, but for us, the problem was how to bring food grains, from where to bring food grains. People are not giving. Fortunately, Ramakrishna Mission has a very good contacts in West Bengal and in Assam. So we talked to the government there. Everybody, started saying, okay, we will allow you to move lorries. Finally, the lorry drivers, they said, we will not go. We are afraid to move. So it was another, with unions, we sat and asked them, you have to bring lorries in. So it was a very big exercise in that sense, that logistics, as Simanji knows about it, getting curfew passes, making people understand what it is, bringing rice and dal. So finally, we could cover this more than 37,400 families, which means around 2.3 lakh people we could cover in Meghalaya in 11 districts out of 12. Remoteness of the coverage was the main thing. We had sometimes 7 to 8 teams going, 7 to 8 trucks, small lorries, going to different places. We took a lot of help from BSF on border area. We took help from the legal services. And then biggest challenge was to get donations. You'll be surprised, Northeast, I never thought that I will get donations. There is no industry there. Who is going to give you donation? Fortunately for me, from the mainland, help came. We could finally distribute rice and dal worth 4.5 crores during the COVID. So all thanks to the donors who came, all small, big, small, what all types of donors we got it. And then the other problem was that there was no PPE. When we started the relief, PPEs were not available. Hospitals wanted PPE. COVID fear was at its height, you know. So nobody wants to take care of the COVID patient. So the PPE also, somehow we got some manufacturers in Calcutta and asked them to supply to government PHEs, CHEs. That we distributed in a long way. And we have some tailoring units and all that. So somehow we could get that also masks made. Now, if you ask the motivation, I think motivation of doing such thing for Ramakrishna monks is always from the teachings of Swami Vivekananda firstly, okay, because it is a part of our genetic makeup that the service to the humanity is the real worship. That is what we always feel. You can worship deities in temples and you can go to churches and mosques, but we always feel, Swami Vivekananda always used to say, that the heart of a human being is the Taj Mahal of all the temples. So if you can serve even a single person and you know bring smile to their faces, that is the best worship you can ever do. So monks of Ramakrishna Mission doing any kind of relief work is not something very big. It is part of our tradition. So that is what we did it, but only thing is it became very big because of the help we received from different people and because our whole team plunged heart and soul into it. That was the thing. Motivation is Swami Vivekananda and Sri Ramakrishna and Ma Sarada Devi. So I think now we can pass on to Dr. Sujit.
It's fantastic to hear these perspectives from both you, Swamiji, and Simanji. I don't have anywhere close to that reach, that much I can tell you, the number of people you all have served. But it's been interesting because one branch of medicine that I was somewhat interested in and got more and more interested in, because as a lung physician, we never anticipated COVID. COVID suddenly came and suddenly all the respiratory physicians across the country are busy, barring those who are 65 plus and, you know, who have not been coming to the hospitals too often, though we have a few even there who are sometimes coming. But we used to see a lot of patients with chronic lung disease for many years. And Suhas knows about this. I've talked to him about these patients on oxygen, suffering, brought in by relatives, possibly going to die in some time. And we wouldn't be surprised if they died in the next year or 2 years. Sometimes they live much longer, and patients today live on oxygen for years as well. But our objective really as a physician is to improve their quality of life, not the quantity. And this branch of medicine, which is called respiratory palliative care, which is about supportive care, the very unrecognized branch across the world. There are very few centers in the world that have really got courses in this. And so we were struggling, actually. But we were continuing to do our work all these years in this field, trying to make chest physicians realize that when you cannot cure certain patients, at least care for them and see that they have a good life and a good death. This is something not very strangely, and I want to ask Swamiji's views on this, that in a country like India where reincarnation is supposed to be the norm amongst the majority of the population, discussing death in the clinic has always been an uncomfortable discussion for the patient and the family. And suddenly with COVID, two things happened. One was the fear of contracting COVID and dying. And the other was actually dying, because there were many patients actually dying. And there were another group of patients who had very mild disease, but just got scared that they'd get it and probably die. So suddenly you find yourself in the unique situation where you can communicate a lot of what you've been wanting to communicate for the last many years. And you have all the time to do it, because you have Zoom, you have video calls with families. And this poor patient is languishing sometimes in an ICU, going to die, or going to go on an invasive ventilator. And everyone is there on the Zoom call, like we are talking right now, sometimes even including the primary consultant, and they've come for to discuss what to do next. And you can actually discuss these things. And we had a Supreme Court law on the right to privacy, as you know, Suhas, in 2017. And that allows a patient to actually take a decision on what he wants. And these discussions were so difficult to do. And suddenly we've just found ourselves flowing in that, myself and my supportive care consultant, where it's been so much easier now to chat with the families and tell them what really makes sense for a patient and what may not make sense. So I think there's been this tremendous awareness of suffering and how to alleviate it. And as a healthcare physician, I believe we should be doing healthcare and not medical care, which seems to be the way hospitals have been progressing. Yeah. It's a lot about what all you can do in a hospital instead of actually improving the health of the patient. And we have been able to do that in the best way possible. But there have been amazing examples, which I can discuss as we go along. But this has been the most satisfying part, to actually talk to families and see every member of the family, no issue of social distancing, and discuss with them their fears, whether they have mild illness, severe. See how health literacy has improved in India in a span of 6 months. What it has done to health literacy is amazing. So there have been a lot of plus points of COVID, if you ask me, but it's been a very, very satisfying experience.
Thanks, Dr. Rajat. So if I were to move the conversation along a little bit, just before we got live, as we were talking about between the four of us, we were talking about us being completely from four different walks of life. But as this happened, as COVID-19 struck, as the lockdowns came in, all of you worked with different people from different walks of life coming together. If, God forbid, similar such situations were to continue for a longer period of time, or similar such situations, new situations were to come in, what do you think from your perspectives, which I would like to believe are very different, what from your perspective should one be doing? How does one come together? How do we prepare ourselves for the future, for situations of this nature? If pandemic is just one type.
I don't think, you prepare yourself for a situation. The situation, in fact, just comes. You have to just take a decision. And I'll say that, life provides you very few opportunities when you can really do something for others. And we should grab with both our hands. And if we miss it, it is our loss. It's the loss of the people whom you would have served. As rightly pointed out by Simanji earlier, somebody else would plunge in and they will do it. Yes. So once you get an opportunity, doing good itself to others, and you becoming a vehicle for doing that good, is a great privilege. See, Swamiji always used to mention this point always, that when we serve another person, he is to be put on a higher pedestal, not the person who is serving. Person who is serving has to sit down and then serve. So, we have to be very always ready and be alert, especially younger generation. And this is a kind of a intoxication doing good itself. the moment you get into it, it gives you tremendous satisfaction. It gives you a very large vision of humanity, of your own self, different dimensions of humanity. It is a very enriching experience, which missing will be very, sorry state of affairs. I'll say that much.
Yeah, and as I think Swamiji said, you can't lose this opportunity, Suhas. If it presents itself and you see this opportunity, it is unbelievable. I know I've spoken to the medical director of my hospital to appoint a supportive care consultant, which means a consultant who focuses on symptoms of the patient and not just disease. And the first question asked is, how much revenue will come to the hospital? And I actually tell him such consultants will ensure the patients go home soon and are able to manage at home. So they say the revenue will go down. I said, yes, but the goodwill will go up. But they don't get it. And that's why we have so few of these consultants. But those consultants who actually enjoy doing it are having the most wonderful experience now, because they're able to now reach out, and the hospital is realizing how much mental health support and less of doing and more of listening is actually helping these patients, and their families. Because doing, in fact, there was an article in an American journal saying that in COVID, in the sick patient, sometimes doing less is actually doing much more, because the less interventions you land up doing, the better the patient is. All that is sometimes needed is good supportive care, oxygen and supportive care, physiotherapy, mobilization, those kind of things. And this is not what improves the revenue model of a hospital overnight, if you understand what I'm saying, Suhas. So hospital managements are not very excited about it, but the goodwill that it brings is unbelievable to the hospital and to patients at large. So you need one patient telling a few more patients that, look, this was a hospital where I felt cared for, that I left discharged, satisfied, or that my relative died, but satisfied. I think that's what should be the objective of hospital and healthcare in any institute. And the satisfaction it gives people like me is unbelievable. I can't even measure it.
Yeah, doctor, what doctor said, that's really amazing. Yeah.
Simanji, if I were to twist the question a little bit for you, same question. How would you want to get these qualities, these thoughts, the basic philosophy of looking for that opportunity to serve others? How would you get this imbibed in children? Our children or the younger people of the nation, of our community?
True. No, it's like there cannot be a straightforward answer to it. But yes, role models like Swamiji, the Ramakrishna Mission, doctors like Dr. Sujit, so many other people, role models who have done some good work, these themselves motivate the young generation. They motivate. In fact, you would be surprised, like I am attending so many webinars and things like that, and they are really like, the first question they say, sir, how we can come into it, how we can help, because as doctor pointed out, now this COVID has made, technology was already there, COVID has taught us how to come closer. Sitting in one-on corners of the world, everywhere we are talking to each other so nicely and discussing, which was unthinkable earlier. If we had to do something, we had to pick a flight, book a ticket, book a guest house and car and all those things, so many things. Because one of my seniors, my college seniors, he's a director of the management institutes in Pune. So he also came to know of my work, and then he said, sir, look, we'll organize a webinar for you to address our management students who are joining induction. I didn't get that word, induction course. So I was just surprised. I said, see, had it been some other occasion, like then the institute has to book a ticket for me, I have to go down, fly down, I have to take a room in the hotel or guest house. So a lot of expenses are there. And then finally, when you land up in the actual venue, the feeling will not be there. That touch, that personal touch will never comes, like we are talking here. So in this way, so many people are coming forward and so many people are getting motivated by seeing examples everywhere. Examples are there, enough of examples. It's not the numbers which are coming. It's hardly if one person is making one change, that counts a lot. Like I'll give an example. When we were sending all these people by train. One of the phone calls, like he was desperately pleading when the train was about to start, 3rd of May, I suppose. The Shramik train started on 3rd of May all over India. We came to know 1 or 2 days in advance that trains will be starting. We were like in administration, we got hints. So, and you know, that the intelligence of these workers and all, you know, it's mind blown. We came to know through our sources. telling sir, khul gaya sir, train chal gaya. I mean, they're telling, I said, nahi chala hai. Nahi chal gaya sir, aapko pata nahi, he's telling. So what do we do? Keep talking to them in their own style and all. But one person was continuously keeping calling, sir, meri wife 8 mahine pregnant hai. She's 8 months pregnant. I have to take her back to Bihar. Ab mere ko pehle train mein ticket dilwai. Like that. So somehow like he was so much pressing me and all, no, then you know, since I was in charge of the movement and all, so I ensured that this family boards the first train. And mind you, there were more than 10 lakh people and hardly 1 or 2 trains started on the 3rd of May. So daily, hardly we could adjust some 1,500 to 2,000 people, slowly them. So this person, and I, it was finished. It went, I managed to get the family on board and I forwarded. Exactly the day the baby was born, I get a photo on my WhatsApp. Okay, I didn't know why. I saw the photo 1 month. I have a photo of that. I suppose I must have told Suhas also that story. Yeah. So one day I could not relay. Then I was busy in my work. Then this fellow called me hesitatingly and he said, "Aapko to yaad nahi hoga, mera ek din ka bachcha hai sir. Aapke chalte bachcha hoga." Because he had no money, he could not go to a hospital in Bangalore, and he had to reach on time to his native place. This small thing, you know.
Sure.
To many people, and then you know it gives you that motivation thing. So similarly, what we do, our younger generation see to it. At least my children, my people who are there with us. Similarly, with doctors around you, your children, your people, and also little bit whatever we do, it really it helps. That is the only training we can give, and leading by example that we can say. It's not that this is the best way, but yes, what came to me as Swamiji said, like. I'm from the police department. We have something called law and order, we say. Law and order, control of law and order, the typical word.
Huh? Yeah.
When we are in the academy, we are taught set of rules as well. When the force comes, we will first use lathi, water cannon and rubber bullets, and then last is firing and all those things. And all. It's all laid down as per rule book. But you know, when actual law and order comes, when we are mobbed by 1,000 people, and then it's only common sense. There is no laid out thing. So common sense, what comes as you take, you just say, no, you grab the opportunity. So this was a situation where you have to use your common sense. Someone is dying, he wants food. I have the power to get him food. So it was like 1 plus 1 becoming 2, 2 plus 2 becoming 4. It was. So it was like you are enjoying it. So like these example, I'll tell you one more example. Sitting in Bangalore, I was office providing food in Kerala, in Gujarat, in Bihar, even in Delhi or Andhra, because just simple way, I used to take their, they used to call me on that number. I used to talk to my batchmates and I used to tell them, look, this is the phone number. And in one place in Kerala, the particular 30 people who were there from Bihar, they're from Jharkhand actually. So they were not able to tell me exactly this place, because what had happened just one day before, the contractor has brought this group from the native place, put them there, and next day this 24th happened. So this contractor has abandoned them. And these people are there in some location. They are not able to exactly tell where it is. So I told him, okay, you come out and get me a photo of any of the buildings, any boards, name board. So he took a snap of a name board. It was some institute was there. It was written in Malayali. I sent it to my batchmate and he located it and he sent relief there. So I used to get through my batchmates and they were waiting for my calls. Afterwards, they see what happened. Bangalore, I was dealing with a heavy, 90% of my work was in Bangalore and Karnataka. 10% which I was dealing in other places, it used to like, they used to wait for my call sometimes. They used to say, tumhara phone nahi aaya abhi tak. Like that. So they used to be like very happy to help me. And in the end, I used to tell them, look, unko, and one more interesting, in one place what happened, when we helped them, so this batchmate of mine, he called me back, he said, I have given each of them 5,000 rupees and 10 days ration. I said, yeah, it's very good. You have some government scheme or what, something, 5,000 rupees and this again. No, yeah, merely ego. I can speak in Hindi also in between. No,
of course you can.
Yes.
What he said? He said, mera ego problem ho gaya. Mere jurisdiction mein usko khana nahi mila. You have come. So what he did, he called that owner of that contractor or some company, they were working in some factory or something. He called and he said, look, why you have done all this? What is there? He said, you pay them their salary or advance, something you pay, you cut it from their salary, give them 5,000 each. So they got 5,000 each, they got ration. So like this, sort of, we started having a sort of, so it is like, it gives you a kick, but yes, you understand the panic, the situation which they were undergoing. For us, it was just an extra phone call receiving. So receiving a phone call was nothing compared to being on the road and doing law and order duty or crime duty or whatever we have to do as a policeman. So it involved an extra bit of patience and time, which I was ready to sacrifice. And once I started doing it, my entire police force, I mean, we had an excellent team. They started getting this thing. They should wait for my calls in the morning. That I used to tell them, and as things progress, I'll just give you a brief. I'll not tell now how it happened, how I mobilized it. And it was so interesting that I was also surprised how it is working. Swamiji will appreciate that. Yeah. You have a system of getting lorries, this, that, and all. Yeah. We are not at all doing that. Hmm. So if Suhas, whenever you tell me, I'll tell that also. 2-3 minutes I'll take, but it's very, very interesting. And you know, my police people, like, they were like doubling up as providers of food, and how that will happen, I'll tell in future.
I will ask you that, Sivanti, because what I'm about to go into is what one would consider in a conversation like this more of management or business type of questions. But there are three things that I start thinking about as I speak with you now, or as I hear you. The three different words come to mind. One is stewardship. So I'll ask a question around that to you, Simanji, shortly. To Dr. Rajan, I will ask you about leadership. And let me start with Swamiji. Let me ask you about logistics. Let me ask you about technology innovation. Your logistics, though you have a large bunch of people or a network, but making all that really work, it's a supply chain of a sort. So making all that work, and similarly, if you were to talk a little bit about, I'll just leave the acronym HICAI, and how you used tablets but docking stations to be able to bring that innovation or that amount of education for the children very frugally. So if we were to start with that, and then we could go over to Dr. Rajan, leadership, and then we'll come back to Simanji's, that one anecdote that he wanted to talk about, which is stewardship.
I think as far as the leadership is concerned, I think already Simanji Kobi and myself also, we have been, you know, managing large workforce before this situation happened. So naturally, administrative acumen is already there as a part of experience with us. So I think that was not the problem. And as far as the logistics was concerned, it was only a question of putting resources together and also trying to reach out to people whom we would have never reached out. And as rightly pointed out, the people responded immediately. You know, goodness as a force, we sometimes forget that goodness motivates people like anything. We have generally heard ki bad company people come together, but that is also true. But goodness has the same amount of pulling power. In fact, I will say much more than that. So if you offer people an opportunity for doing selfless work, helping others, they respond. And same thing, my experience also was same. I never expected help from people whom I approached, and I saw the response where I never thought I will get it. So that was something. And then one same is equation 1 + 1 = 2 and 2 + 2 = 4. You try, you knock, and the doors gets opened. You keep on trying. So the intensity, the feeling, and the you are also becoming an example for your team, and your team become example for somebody else. So it is kind of a infection. It's more like a COVID virus, but in a positive way, which motivated people. As far as the technology is concerned, you see what happens the moment we finished essential reliefs, both providing food, providing medical services, and all that. So naturally, I am running a lot of schools. So the question of online classes started, bothering everyone. Children were not going to schools for almost 6 months. It's almost going to be 6 months now. So everybody started asking what will happen to their growth. After all, if you do not feed academic inputs to a growing child, there is a problem of personality not flowering properly, the mind not developing properly. So we thought, no, this is not it. So let's start with some online classes. So the moment this idea came that we'll start some online classes for children of our school, we said, when we are putting so much of effort to create online course material from classes 1 to 12, why should we restrict that accessibility? Why not make it available to the whole of Meghalaya? And 11, 12 is standard. The whole of India, they can use that. It's a same syllabus. So we thought we will not only make it, first we'll make quality products. Then see that it is accessible to everybody, not only to the students of our schools, because we are not into business. We'll make it free, freely accessible. So Hikai is in fact in Khashi, those who do not know, Hikai means to teach. That was designed by one of our well-wishers, Hybrid Interactive Knowledge Assimilation Initiative. So that was made into Hikai. And then what happened, we are in border area. And if I come to border area, there is no network. I will get into Bangladesh network much, much more easily than I get any other network. So this problem came that even if you provide online courses, if network is not there, it is not going to be feasible. So we have to provide some kind of a system where offline people can work. So then the technology comes in. So we did 2-3 technological innovations there. And the first innovation was this, that we created a kind of towers. We use routers to create a Wi-Fi zone, what we call it intranet zones. So in a remote area, in a marketplace where people always come, we have put a router and created a Wi-Fi zone of a kilometer radius so that the children, anybody who comes within that Wi-Fi range can download the videos and upload the assignments and all that thing. So this was something which was done for areas where there is no internet accessibility at all. So here the technology came into it, this kind of accessibility to students. So each village you have to create wherever there is an internet shadow zone or there is no internet. The second point which we came across, the problem was that the parents were very apprehensive. They have to provide Android phones with SIM cards and all that to children, and it will get misused. You know, that kind of apprehension came in. So then again, we said, okay, so we will go for first a cheaper device, which is not an Android phone. Android phone, costs you anywhere 8,000 to 9,000 rupees. So we went for tablets, and the tablets without SIM card. And only the kind of communication is possible is using the Wi-Fi network. So the parent's Wi-Fi gets connected to the child's tablet, and then they can just use that much of the program which they require. So that is how we brought in the Wi-Fi tablets, preloaded it with the whatever we had already videos we have made it, and whatever new videos we were uploading that they were getting from their parents using that Wi-Fi network. So that was the another innovation which we had to do to overcome the anxiety of the parents. So Hikai, now today we have launched, it's almost for more than 2.5 months. More than 165 schools are using it. this program, apart from the Ramakrishna Mission schools. We have students using from different parts of India, different states, and you'll be surprised. I have one person from Canada using it. I don't know what is the, how is what he's interested. So somebody is using from there also. It's an absolutely free platform. And we have made is an app-based device, a particular app was designed for the tablets so that it can offer you some features whereby the teachers can monitor the progress of students. You know, they can know how long the videos have been watched, it was paused or skipped or all that. So from there itself, they can see and then guide the students. And then it is an interactive, it has an interactive platform. It offers you, in fact, better alternatives than even what the Google platform provides you.